Okay, hello everyone. So I will be talking today about 5G Mac. So this is multi-access edge computing or mobile edge computing, depending on when you look at the history of this shortcut. And I would like to show it to you as an enabler for the factory of the future. So if you look at Industry 4.0 and a lot of initiatives, they are ongoing, but it's going pretty slow. It's really hard to justify anything over like a simple pilot or a small introduction in just one division. And what's really needed, as we see right now, talking to our customers, are quick wins and really fast return on investment, especially after COVID times when companies are looking more closely into every dollar they spend. This is really important to show results quickly. And we think, and we also have seen from the real implementations, that this could be one way to achieve it. So just to clarify to everyone what Mac actually is, so that we are on the same page and we can start the discussion, is Mac is a mobile edge. So basically, if you look at the picture here, what you can achieve is to move from really long latency to very short one, thanks to moving all of your computing next to the factory. So if you imagine right now that you have an application running in the cloud, it needs to communicate over the telecom operator's network through the internet and to the cloud where your application is hosted. So with Mac, actually, you move all of this just next to the rooftop of your factory where the base station is. So if you look what it's bringing to you, it actually brings you the same power and flexibility that you get from your cloud computing, and you can achieve best of the both worlds. So your standard use cases where you have your robotics, your drone control, or AGVs, like my colleague from BMW earlier presented. This is really important to have it in a fast way, but also close to the factory, so not exposing this data out. And Edge is one solution to achieve that. So if you look at the benefits of Mac, there are some of them which are obvious if you look at the 5G commercials, which are the latency and the throughput. And it's not the only thing that is really important. So from my perspective, customers now are looking into 5G and into investments mostly because of the fact the amount of devices that you have on one square kilometer, like around even up to 1 million devices, and also really small energy consumption, so that you can put a lot of small devices which are running on the battery power, and this still makes sense. So this is also important to remember that 5G is not only about the latency and not only about throughput. So this is also interesting for cloud providers. So if you look here in an example, this is an example based on AWS Wavelength, but the same you get from all the bigger cloud providers like Azure or Google. And also, you can build the same infrastructure based off open source solutions, which are another great option to consider. But nevertheless, if you look here, you have your private enterprise network, which is your on-premise data center. This could be AWS Outpost, or this could be your standard VMware or OpenStack-based data center. And what you can do, as you see on the left bottom side, there is a AWS Wavelength, which is part of the communication provider domain, so your like T-Mobiles or Sprints of the current world. And they are hosting actually the application on the edge. What it gives you is that you can use all the benefits of the telecom network provider. So basically, if they have any kind of signaling data or data about the location and so on, you can benefit out of this without additional need of any implementation, just using them exposed via APIs. You may ask where the world is now with 5G. So it's getting more and more traction, and it's getting more and more popular. So in a lot of bigger part of Germany and UK, US especially, and also some of the bigger industrial areas and bigger cities in other European countries, it's fairly popular right now, and it's really growing. So I expect that the end of this year or in the middle of next one, most of Europe will have enough coverage that you could build industrial use cases, and especially your local telecom operators would be very happy to a deployer based station, especially for you if they have a use case, because that's also beneficial for them. And if you look at what's happening on the major cloud providers, on AWS, Azure, or on Google, they all have services dedicated to the edge computing, and they are cooperating with different telecom companies to provide it. And launches are happening throughout the year, and they are not stopped in any way by COVID or any kind of economical reasons. So this is something that is continuing, it's growing, and you can see a lot of deployments. What is used right now, for example, one of our customers, Schmitz Cargobu, for whom we developed the application for smart logistics and monitoring the trailer, which is quite nice because it has a lot of sensors built in into the trailer and a lot of data gathered, so you can monitor your whole vehicle fleet with a simple mobile app, which is very convenient both for the drivers and also for logistics operators. As well as we are cooperating with Vobit, this is a local company out of Poland, which is building AGVs. And we are building a follow me solution for them, where basically it can detect, identify and authenticate an operator and follow him all around the factory. So we don't have to have a predefined route. And actually this is just following people working there and helping them with their daily jobs. But this of course are the use cases of like right now, and what's being more and more popular and more important, and the main topic of this presentation actually is what's possible with 5G thanks to its throughput. So basically you can have really a huge amount of devices, and this was tested for example on the football stadium by KDDI, that you can have thousands of devices streaming really high quality videos in parallel on the same network and on the same location, because more or less like a football stadium is pretty similar in the size of a bigger factory. And what it gives you is actually enabling the computer vision. So if you look at the state of computer vision like 2 or 3 years ago even, you can see that this is not that great. Of course, it can do some simple detection. If you have like a camera picture from the car, it can differentiate from other cars, the road and so on, but it's not that sharp and not that clear was there. It's missing the signs. But if you go a little bit, couple of months forward, it gets more and more accurate and more precise. So here you can see the results from, I would say, like a year ago. And if you go to more modern applications, you can easily detect different objects like traffic lights, people and animals, and also their state. And what's going even forward for today, you actually get a stereoscopic vision. So you have the full 3D model of the surrounding environment with all the data and also all the vectors. So when something is moving, you can predict where it will be in a second or two just from the way it was behaving previously, as well as you get a lot of metadata about the objects that are in the scene. So with the state of computer vision that you have today, you can actually use it for more use cases which are related to factory and in general industry 4.0. So starting from a simple use case here where you can see that it's detecting an operator and a hot saw and it can do some kind of warning for them, to more complex ones where you see that there is like a defect detected on the bottle, or to even more interesting ones where it's doing inspection of both big components being produced like a full car, as well as really small components like electronic pieces. And it can also do like visual inspection of the assembly. If you look at the labels here and at the beer bottles, for example. Another use case that you get with a camera, it's like a thermal camera and thermal imaging, where you get a lot more data and you can observe the machinery and also do like the predictive maintenance or detect any kind of failure that is happening. And it can go even up to the like a proper monitoring of really complex pieces with getting data from sensors on top of the camera stream. So this is really important up to the point that you can really steer the whole environment, detect people, parts connected with SAP or any kind of system that is tracking your parts and goods in the warehouse. And thanks to that, you can really quickly go to the results. So if we go to a practical implementation, because you may see this as like a complex thing or something that requires a lot of time to implement, but actually there are already ready-made solutions coming out of companies like Seek or Baluf, where you get cameras which are ready to do 2D or 3D machine vision, also with thermal imaging. And what you can do is connect it with the currently available cloud solutions. So if you look, for example, at the stuff that is available on AWS right now, like services like recognition for video, SageMaker, and Kinesis for real-time streaming, you can really build a proper end-to-end solution. So what it gives you, if you ask in a real-time timeline, coming out with an idea to introduce machine vision and cameras into your factory, you start from a simple proof of concept where the cameras are located in a certain place and the whole infrastructure is set up. And you are getting like in around 4 weeks first results, and you can see what's possible and what's not in your particular setting, depending on your lighting conditions, the amount of dust in the factory, and so on. So you can see how good it is and what are the possibilities. Later on, we usually go with our customers with an MVP, and this MVP phase lasts between 2 to 3 months, where we get really end-to-end solution. It's not fully fledged and finished to run in production in the entire factory, but for example, in a certain line is something that you can test out and work on. And then from there, take a decision if you want to build up the full end-to-end solution or not. So if you would like to try it, it would be really important for us if you could send us a sample of your like floor plan and any kind of data that you are collecting right now from the sensors. We can analyze it and let you know what is the art of the possible and how we could help you in real use cases. So this concludes the presentation. I will now go to the questions. So feel free to put on the chat anything that you'd like to ask about machine vision in general and its introduction in factories or logistics. Okay, there's a question from Philip. What do you find is the biggest barrier to manufacturers embracing 5G as a solution? Okay, so first of all, there is a mindset barrier. Of course, you can see a lot of misinformation about like the funny things around 5G and that it produces different problems or diseases, but kind of setting the jokes aside, so the biggest thing is actually the introduction of the network itself. So if the factory is not located in a big industrial area and not next to a big city, but rather in a remote location, this would be really tough and difficult because these locations are not priority places for telecom operators. And this would require negotiations with them to put basically 5G coverage in this area. But if you are in a big industrial park or inside a major city, this wouldn't be a problem. Okay then, so thank you very much for listening and enjoy the rest of the conference.